ओम श्री हरिं परमानंदं उपदेष्टारं ईश्वरं व्यापकं सर्वलोकानां कारणं तं नमाम्यहम्। लास्ट टू वीक्स वी हैड अबाउट फोर क्लासेस ऑफ अपरोक्ष अनुभूति एंड वी मीट आफ्टर फाइव डेज गैप एंड द स्टडी इज नॉट एकेडमिक। Study is trying to experience something. And so we must get connected to the point where we left last time. Without this connection, we cannot proceed. So you see, from the beginning, the name of the book is Aparoksha Anubhuti. Our so-called Pratyaksha has been found out to be non-Pratyaksha. Paroksha is already Paroksha. So without the mediacy of indriyas or mind, we have to realize, perceive, experience our own real nature. And so it can be by a process or method in which indriyas or mind is not involved. Last class. Indriyas or mind are not involved. We know ourselves more directly than we know anything of this world. By removing the mixture in it of hundreds of things, we have to get the super conscious or real and non-indirect knowledge of the self. That is the name of the book. Now, to begin with, Shankaracharya bows down to Shri Hari, that is Vishnu, the all-pervading God, indicating that it is the all-pervading God or Sagun Brahma through which we can reach the Nirguna Brahma. And our teacher, whoever that may be, a good teacher, is nothing but God has come to teach us through that form. So, Upadeshtaram, he is the all-pervading, he is the cause of all. I bow down to him. And then in the second shloka he says, good people only can look at it again and again so that to get that aparoksha anubhuti by which they will become mukta, moksha siddhaye. And then by doing their duties proper for their situation in life, both the development of the body and mind and the position in the society which they hold, the righteous actions according to that position they must perform, and they should never have, then they should never seek comfort, luxury, and try to be austere in the sense that their mind and indriya should always be focused on the one goal of life. And then what happens? The Lord, the universal self, which is within us already, he becomes pleased. And it is by his pleasure only that we get fitness for listening to Vedanta. And that fitness consists of four apparent qualities. Apparent because one of the qualities contains six. So the total becomes nine in that way. Qualifications of our mind. No external qualification is sought here, please. No question of sannyasi grahastha, no question of stri purush. If you have this thing, that is the fitness. And that fitness is, vairagya starts from the spirit of renunciation, the dispassion, the disgust for the present life to seek the real nature. And then this enables us to do right discrimination between what is permanent and what is not permanent, what is real and what is not real. And then we start practicing control of the mind, control of the body, withdrawal of the mind from outgoing tendency, shama dama uparati. Bearing the dwells in life, pritiksha, and trying always to put our mind in God, maybe saguna, nirguna, whatever. In some form of God, we must always try to put our mind, samadhan, and we should have not faith, but we should have the spirit that though I do not realize this, the sages have realized, my guru has realized, and is telling me not only the truth, but the process by which to reach the truth. Why should I not try? This is called Shraddha. And behind all this is the mumuksha, the keen desire to be liberated in life. So then he starts describing in his own words what are these different characteristics. He says that as we despise the excreta of a crow, same attribute we should have for any enjoyment, even Brahma's enjoyment or the enjoyment of a tree. In between comes man, man rich, poor, or any stage. The enjoyment which he has, we should have a dispassion for this enjoyment. One illustration is given by certain saints, two I will say. We are hungry and a delicious food is kept in the plate before us. But before we start eating, somebody comes and says there is poison in that food. Then what spirit will have? Dispassion. Other persons have described, when we are about to start eating food, unfortunately, one fly has entered our mouth, gone into our throat, and we get terrible nauseatic feeling, and we cannot release the food at all. That type of dispassion we should have. And then, viveka means the nature of the self is permanent. And whatever we see, outside world, our own body, everything is of a different type, that is Nashvara, Kshanabhangura. This determination, this Nishaya, is called Viveka. And then, due to this, Shankara's definitions, now unique definitions for what we hear routinely, always give up desires. That is the best way to control the mind. Don't try to control it, it will revolt. But always give up desires. Then mind becomes controlled. And the outgoing tendency of the body, indriyas, mind, if you check that, then indriyas and body become controlled. And then, whatever tendency is left to go outside, that you bring it inside, paravritti, make it come back by thinking of God. That is called real parama uparati. And then, as Patanjali has suggested, as Bhagavan Buddha suggested, dukkham eva sarvam vivekinam. Everything in this world is misery to the man of discrimination. Now, what to do with that misery? What cannot be cured has to be endured. Now, this endurance is not sama. This is almost neglecting, just going on bearing, and we have to go beyond finally. So, this is called titiksha. Shubha Titiksha, holy Titiksha, auspicious Titiksha. Then, Nigama is the conclusive Shastras, which are the Vedas, and our teacher who has realized them. If they say something, we should feel a devotion for that, a love and respect for that. That is called Shraddha. Wonderful definition. Shraddha requires bhakti. Bhakti is equal to shraddha, no? Because when bhakti comes, that is attraction, love plus respect, that it is something noble, it is something high. What which the guru is telling, which the scriptures, conclusive scriptures are telling, which the Vedanta is telling, then the tendency to go towards that will come, shraddha. And then the chitta should be made one pointed in Brahman, sat lakshe. Sat is Brahman. Brahman is the aim towards which the chitta, chitta is tranquil state of the mind. So the mind has to be tranquilized and one pointed towards Brahman. That is called samadhanam, keeping rightly. It is not simply pampering the small child like. That contentment is not meant here. Samyak adhan, mind can be kept properly only in God. And so, the continuous attempt at putting mind in God, sat lakshe, keeping him as the aim of life, that is called samadha. And then, mumuksha, sansara bandha nirmukti katam mesha kadavide. So the anxious mind seeks, how shall I get free from the bondage of the transmigration? By what method I shall become free? This sort of hankering, this sort of anxious thought is called mumuksha. And the buddhi, our bodha, should be firm on this point, not wavering. Always we should have this, how shall I get mukti? By what method I shall get mukti? When this is become firm in our life, then that is called mumukshuta. Then he told, suppose you have got this. One more point has to intervene here. That supposing that you have heard Vedanta, supposing, because Nigamacharyeshu Vakya Shraddha, so you have definitely heard what the Guru is telling, what the Shastras are telling about the aim of life, about the nature of ultimate truth, that is taken for granted here, assumed here. Behind which are first is Shravana, and the truth shines in us with that Shravana. Because of the Sadhana Chatushtaya, that truth becomes a glimpse at least, a sort of experience at least. Then only this thinking is possible. It is not a simply something like ratiocination. It is an experiential thought. So, vichara here does not mean a dry intellectual thinking. It means a deep hankering for God, deep hankering to become mukti, and devotion for what the scriptures are telling and Guru is telling. Basing on that, this discrimination. Ukta sadhana yukte na vichara purushenahi. One who has got this sadhana, in which definitely there is the knowledge, theoretical, of the goal of life, of the nature of reality, and an hankering to get bondage released, to get freedom. With these two qualities and other prerequisites, only vairagya, vivek and all that, then only this so-called vichara stands. Otherwise, many philosophers may think of many things, nothing comes to our life. So this vichara is not simply an intellectual process. It is being done by ukta sadhana yukte na. One who has already got the sadhanas which come by the grace of God, which comes by our karma and tapasya, grace of God comes. By grace of God, we get the fitness for Vedanta, and the fitness includes having heard the Vedanta from the Guru and Shastras and mumukshuta, and then those person should do this sort of discriminative thinking. Vichara is discriminative thinking. What is discriminative thinking? And why we are doing that? Jnana Siddhartham. That means knowledge has come to us. Maybe theoretical today, maybe with a glimpse today, but it has to become perfect. So the process of vichara is from jnana having touch to come to perfection, jnana siddhartham, because we want that good should happen to us, auspicious should happen to us. When that desire is there, desire is not like other desires. The word is desire. And some people say, if there is desire for God, what is the difference from other desire? Word only is same. Language, what can we get to? Desire for God is opposite to desires of the world. Desires of the world are subject-object enjoyment. Desire for God is to get rid of subject-object enjoyment, to seek one reality without the second. So, seeking good for us means always seeking God, and such a man has to do discriminative thinking. Now, notpadyate vina jnana vicharena anya sadhane yatha padartha bhanam hi prakashena vina kvachit. He gives an example. Without example, we cannot understand by mere tarka. Without light, we cannot be aware of a particular object, of any object. Similarly, if we do not throw the light of discrimination, we cannot realize God. The jnana will not be born in us unless we take resort to discriminative analysis based upon our vivek, vairagya, shraddha, samadhan. Basing upon this, we have to enter into discriminative analysis, without which the knowledge will not flash, because we are already that. But we have become mixed up in our mind. And so the discriminative knowledge will reveal what we really are. That is the process. Now, that discriminative thinking, Shankaracharya is teaching us. What is the matter for thinking? He says, Koham, who am I? Katham idam jatam, how this world has come into existence? Kovai karta se vidyate, who is its karta, doer? Upadanam kim astiha, what is the material cause of this world? This is thinking. Discriminative thinking, he proposes only 4 points of discussion. 3 are apparently about the world, 1 is about ourselves, but that is the first one. Who am I? That is a discriminatory thinking. Because I am body, I am mind, I am this, I am that. What really I am? And how this world has come into existence, which I am experiencing. Somebody is the creator. And what is the material from which the world has come? Then, first point is, who am I? Naham bhutagano deho, naham cha akshagana tatha, etad vilakshana kashchit vichara soyam idrisha. I am not matter. Bhutagana means a group of materials. I am not a group of materials. Deho. The group of materials makes the body. I am not bhutagano deho. I am not body which is composed of certain materials. Naham cha akshagana sata. Instruments are not myself. They are my instruments. My aksha is eyes. Eyes, ear, nose, tongue, skin. These are our instruments of knowledge. That is not me. So, we should be able to separate the real I from the instruments which are. So first is body, second is the instruments. Then who am I? I am not yet determined. I have not been able to find. But etad vilakshana kashchit, something which lakshana, the characteristics of which are totally different from my body and my indriya. That is the soyam vichara soyam idrisha. This is the discriminative thinking. Next point. From where has this world come? How this world has come? Ajnana prabhavam sarvam jnanena pradilayate. Along with the world has come, but goes back also. That must be thought of. Because we do not know the real nature of ourselves. Because we have all wrong ideas of ourselves or the world has come out. This is a very path-breaking, unique type of discrimination. So he has heard Vedanta sufficiently from his acharya and from the scriptures. And so he says that Shankara has defined it, if you want, in detail in the preface to Brahma Sutra Bhashya. Consciousness can never become associated with matter. But in our practical life, we see, I am this, I am that, is always associated with matter. This is called ajnana, the wrong thinking, the wrong consciousness, not only thinking. It is not I think like this, I feel like this. My knowledge is like that. And that is why it is called ajnana. My thinking, my feeling is based upon my knowledge that I am a jiva. I do this, I think this, who is I? This jiva. A subject living in the midst of objects. That is our basic consciousness. And that is wrong. So, because of this, we see the world. That is how one should be able to think. And then, we should always also understand together with that, the world not being real, one day it will vanish. In deep sleep, it vanishes. In samadhi, certainly it vanishes. When the pralaya comes, it vanishes. So it can't be real that way. And this is called discriminative thinking. Also, who is the karta? Sankalpa. In my mind, some thought arises, some idea arises. And then the world comes out. In God's mind, you may say, some idea arises. And then we see the world. Very fundamental thinking, not normal thinking. What is the, from where, how the world comes? Due to ajnana. And remember, it goes away also. Who is the karta? The idea. By example, we can understand this. When I get an idea, I should make a garden. Then the garden comes out in practical life. When God gets the idea, let me be many, then he becomes many. So what is the karta? He does not say Ishwara is the karta. He says that idea is the karta. If the implication is that if our mind is free from ideas, we shall not see the world at all. It is not so-called idealism. Let us not discuss it here. But the world comes out, the karta of the world is idea, that is sankalpa. Vivida sankalpa. We get different ideas and so the different world comes out. God has different ideas, so different world comes out. He said, this is the nature of discriminative thinking which I have told you. Then, what is the upadana? Etayor yad upadanam ekam sukshmam sat avyayam yathaiva mrudghatadinam vichara soyam idrisha. In every logic in India, there has to be an example. So, what is the upadan for the jars? Clay. As clay is the upadan of the jars, who is the upadan? See, very wonderful thinking here. God is the upadan, he says. Sankalpa is the karta. Ajnana, from the world comes out of ajnana. Sankalpa is the karta. Upadana is God. What is Upadana? Ekam. Ekam eva dvitiyam. One only is the Upadana. It appears as many. Sukshmam. That one is not seen by the indriyas, not conceivable by the mind, not even caught by eye consciousness. That is called Sukshma. Sat Brahman. It is the reality. It is the reality of Vayam, unchanging reality. Not becoming less. If he creates the world out of himself, he does not become less. So, this is the Upadana. Is it not a revolutionary thought? God is the Upadana. Sankalpa is the Karta. Ajnana from the world comes and goes back. This is called discriminative knowledge. We read up to this up to in the last class, 15. Now we proceed. Now revise our thought of I. 4 points proposed, 4 points have been discussed. Now mutual relation between aham ekopi sukshmascha gyata sakshi sat avyayah tad aham natra sandeho vicharaha soyam idrisha. Real I which we feel is continuously changing, it cannot be I. It's shifting, it cannot be I. It is a subject amongst objects, it cannot be I. What I can be, one without a second. That which I thought as Upadana is my Upadana also. Other than which I do not exist. Sukshmasya, same characteristic which he told there. I am not what I see. I am not what I feel. I am not what my consciousness tells me. I am subtlest where these things do not reach. Aparokshana, we have to get it. Jnata, the knower. I see my eye. So that eye is not me. An object is never my eye. Eternal subject. A subject not in, let us take an example of the dream. We dreamed that I went to London or I ate a mango. Waking up, we know that both London and I were products of my mind because the I was sleeping on the cot. Both the mango and I were products of the mind because I was sleeping on the cot. Now, transfer this knowledge to the waking state. I am doing this, no? I am doing this, both are objects of a real I. I am going there, I am seeing this, both are objects of the real I. So, a subject which is not in relation with objects, that is jnata, that is consciousness, that is self-conscious, self-luminous entity, that alone can be called I. You say, how and what? He has already transcended all this because he has heard from his guru and shastra the nature of reality. And so, first he said, aham, I am not the matter, not the body. Now, thinking of all this, he said, what I am, not only I am not this, I am not this, what I am one without a second. I am the subtlest, I am the subject, objectless subject, Sakshi. Sakshi means no change comes in me. Example, desert appears as water. It does not become wet. So the world like a passing show, including this I, born again and dies along with the world. But I remain eternally unchanging knower. That is Sakshi. This is what is discriminative thinking, my dear. And one should have the capacity, the boldness to think like this. Sat, I am Brahman. I am the only reality. Avyaya, So, repetition of what was told as Upadan, the Brahma Upadan, is now being told as I. Having understood that everything is made of that, I am also made of that. And this I should be aware of. Tadam natra sandeho, that I am, there is no doubt about it. We have not realized that, but that should be our thought process. That is called thinking. That is called discriminative thinking. When I am able to always think, I am that one. Vichara soyam idrisha. This is what is called the discriminative thinking. So, for discriminative thinking, he had proposed four subjects, and after discussing the four, the combination of all these thoughts or the conclusion of all these thoughts he has presented into real nature of I. That should be our permanent thinking. Then, now the question is, from Ajnana world comes, he has told. Now he's showing the presence of Ajnana. How the world comes out of Ajnana? What is Ajnana? So, in the next few shlokas, he shows the wrong knowledge going on in us already. Atma, my reality. Atma vinishkalo yeko deho bhovir avruta tayor aikyam prapashyanti kim ajnanam atah param. Atma is without parts. Atma is consciousness. Atma is infinite. Infinity cannot have parts. Consciousness has no dimensions. It cannot have parts. It is not a physical entity to have parts. He echo. And I should be one throughout the world. Echo means one throughout the world. If I am separate, he is separate already, parts have come. If I am separate and you are separate, parts have come. And so, I should be, my real nature should be the whole world. My real nature should be universal. My real nature should be one without a second. That is real nature of mine. Atma is not a substance. Huh? Atma is my own real nature. Deho bahuviravruta. Well, my body is made of so many parts. It is covered by so many parts. It is made of so many parts. And yet, how can I identify with Atma, with body? Tayor aikyam prapashyanti. How we see the unity between the real nature of I and this body? What more ignorance you want, he says. When Master Mahasaya went to Thakur, and Thakur asked him, how is your wife? Vidya Shakti or Avidya Shakti? Master Mahasaya could not catch it. She says she is nice, but ignorant. Thakur immediately remarked, and you are knower. So this subject-to-object knowledge is no knowledge, it is ignorance. In all this, we are taking for granted, I am the body, which I can't be. Body is material. Body is made of many parts, and I am without parts, one without a second. These two things only are sufficient to show that I am not the body. And there is made of many things, and we see the unity of them. What more ignorance or wrong knowledge can be there? Atma niyamaka shanta. Deho bhaiyo niyamakaha niyamyakaha tayor aikyam prapashyanti kim ajnanam atah param. Atma, or the real nature, is always the controller. The transcendent immanent reality, the all-pervading reality which is beyond all, is always the controller and inner. Atman is deep inside, and there is outside and being controlled by myself. There is outside and something being controlled by myself. How can they be one? And if you see they are one, what more ignorance or wrong knowledge can be there? So the wrong knowledge here is being shown between my real nature and the body. Atma jnanamaya punyo deho mamsamayo ashuchi tayor aikyam prapashyanti kim ajnanam atah param. Atma is made of consciousness and it is holy. Holiest is Atma. Body made of flesh and dirty. From outside we may put lipsticks and pomades and try to appear beautiful. Inside the body is dirty and made of flesh. And to think I am the body, to think that I and body are same, what more ignorance can be there? You see, here I am telling you one thing. Shankaracharya's books or utterances have a force. They are not just plain facts. All his personality is involved in that. They have got great force. And so he is boldly proposing. Think like this. Atma is controller. How, why? Read Vedanta, you will see. Atma is controller. Atma is inside. Atma means my real nature. And there is outside and there is made of flesh. And if we see they are one, what more ignorance or wrong knowledge can be there? Atma prakashaka svacho deha tamasa uchyate tayor aikyam prapashyanti kim ajnanam atah param. Atma is the revealer. Atma is the light which reveals. Light is not physical light here. Inner consciousness which reveals, which makes us know things. That is revealing. Svachya. And because of that, it is pure. Because there is no possibility of anything adulteration or mixture, it is only light, not physical light. It is the light of consciousness. It is only without dimensions, without parts. So there is no chance of it becoming impure. It is always pure, svachya, nirmal. And what is body? Body is tamogun. Body is an inert object, that is tamas. Body is an inert object. And we feel we are one with the body. What more ignorance or wrong knowledge can be there? Atma nityo hi sadrupo deho anityo hi asanmayaha tayor aikyam prapashyanti kim ajnanam atah param. My real nature is nitya, unchanging, constant, and of the nature of reality, sadrupo. My real nature is of the nature of reality, Brahman, and unchanging. Deha is temporary, they are changing every moment, there is nashwar. And another important thing is sitting here, very important. I used to hear this from my guru always. He used to tell about the world, here it is about the deha. Asan mayaha. Deha is filled with, deha is the filled with unreality. My Guruji's words were, the world is made of inherent zeroness, inherent nihilism. What is the world made of? Not wood and stone, inherent nihilism. This is what my body is made of. This is the revolutionary thinking which will lead to aparokshanubhuti, not otherwise. We have to remove, throw away these things from our consciousness, not only thinking. And so he says, Atma is, deha is made of unreal things. Asan maya, deha is made of, constituted of unreality. Anitya should lead us to think that it is unreal. Deha is anitya and unreal. Atma is nitya and real. And yet we feel, I am the body. But more ignorance or wrong knowledge can be there. Now, Atman has been told again and again as light. What type of light Atman is, that being discussed in the Shloka 22. Atmana tat prakashatvam yat padartha avabhasanam nagnyadi diptivat diptir bhavati andyam yato nishi. It is not a physical light that he wants to tell. What is the light of the Atman? Which makes me experience, which reveals to me all the objects, which reveals my mind, which gives light to my mind, which gives light to my indriyas, which reveal the objects for me. That is Atma's light. That is Atma's prakashatvam, yat padartha avabhasanam. All the objects of the world, including my body and everything, are revealed, are given to me as experience. It is not the light of the Agni. Why? In the night, suppose we are not burning the fire, we get darkness. So Agni, Surya, Chandra, being physical light, have limited capacity space-wise, time-wise. Surya may be prakashing everything, but if I am sitting behind a wall, Surya is not making me prakashing. In the night, Surya is gone. Chandra comes only in the night. Agni is a very limited thing. So like this, don't think light of the Atman is. Atman has not a physical light, which is limited by its very nature. Andam yato nishi. Because, yato means because in the night we get darkness. Now, Atman doesn't, if we see darkness, that also Atman is revealing. Our consciousness is revealing that we are perceiving darkness. Agni does not reveal that. If I close my eyes, I do not see anything. But Atman reveals to me that I have closed my eyes and I am not seeing anything. So the presence of something, the absence of something, all that is revealed to me by the light of the knowledge. Such a diagonally opposite the thing is very important to think. Some people think some light I see. I remember here a very funny conversation. You don't take it amiss. One somebody, yogi like, came to meet my Guruji. Guruji was sitting on a chair near the wall. He sat and said, "Sir, do you see light?" There was a switch on the wall just behind where Guruji was sitting. He switched it on. "Yes, when I want light, I switch on the light." That man became upset. "I'm telling you seriously, asking seriously whether you say light." He says, "I'm telling you seriously. Whenever I want light, I switch on the bulb." The meaning was that these are very ordinary things. These lights and somebody sees black and blue and they become very great Mahatmas and they get thousands of followers. That is not Atma's light, huh? Atman light is that which reveals everything. You cannot understand light independently unless it reveals some object to you. And so, it is not like physical light, which is limited in its capacity. It leaves many things dark, time-wise, space-wise. Well, even the darkness is revealed by Atman. No question of time and space. We may be sleeping. God never sleeps. He knows the world is sleeping. That is Atman. That is my real nature. Even in deep sleep, it has not vanished. It reveals to me that we are sleeping. So, Now, ignorance he was doing again and again. Now he calls it foolishness. Deho aham iti ayam mudo. Dhrutva tishtati aho janah. Mama ayam iti api jnatva. Gata drishteva sarvada. Though we know all of us that body is mine, whether mine or not, we shall see later. But very beginning, we know my body. Then how I body? When body is mine, how it becomes I? My pen, my table, my chair, my eyes, they do not become me. So he gives an example. There is a jar. I am seeing the jar. Do I become the jar? Jar belongs to me. All right. Do you become the jar? So, deho aham iti ayam mudo. This body is mine. This is the mudata, foolishness. Dhrutva, holding this, tishtati aho jana. Aho, alas, all the people holding themselves to be body, they are sitting quiet. Mama, I am iti api jnatva, though they know that it is mine, not I. I and my difference itself becomes lost. Though we know that body is mine, and yet, how body becomes I? And people holding on to this body is I, they are sitting quiet, their foolishness. Just like the gata drashta, their jar is being seen by somebody, always he does not say, I am the jar. So, outside example is given beautifully to illustrate that I am not the body. And to think, up till now I was telling it is ajnana or wrong knowledge, and now he is telling that it is mudata. Then, come back, what I am? So the purpose is to get aparokshanubhuti by filtering out that which I am not. Brahma 24. Brahmaivaham samashanta satchida ananda lakshana naham dehohi asadrupo jnanam ityuchyate buddhai. Buddhai means the wise people. What they call as knowledge? Not reading books. I am Brahman. I am Sama. I am equally present and same to all the people. In all the states of the mind, I am Sama. Sama has two connotations. In all the sukha dukkha and everything of life, pain and pleasure, I am Sama. And everything outside may be various, but I am Sama. Shanta. There is nothing which can disturb me at all. Because I am Brahman. What is the nature of that Brahman? What is the characteristic of the Brahman? Three things only can be told of. Sat, Chit and Ananda. It is reality, it is consciousness, it is bliss. These are its characteristics. So I am Brahman, which is, Brahman means all pervading reality, transcendent immanent reality. I am that. I am same inside and outside. I am at peace with myself and with the world. I am of the nature of existence, consciousness, bliss. I am not this body, which is of the nature of unreality. That is stress again. Asadrupo. This body which is of the nature of unreality, I am not this. The wise man calls this as knowledge. Not by reading books, by the change of consciousness, by seeing that I am Brahman. And not this body. This is knowledge. Nirvikaro, nirakaro, niravadyo, aham avyayaha, naham deho hi asadrupo, jnanam ityuchyate buddhai. The wise man calls this as knowledge. I am nirvikar. There is never any change in me. There is never any modification in me. I do not become angry. I do not become happy. That is mind. I do not become attached. I do not become detached. That is mind. I am nirvikar, absolutely unchanging, nirakar. Body has a form, mind has a form, subtle form. What is my form? Can consciousness pure have any form? Can consciousness pure have any dimension? Consciousness pure can have any parts. So what is this form? This you have to visualize. This you have to try to experience. This you have to input in ourselves that I have no form. Niravadyo, there is nothing which blemishes me. I am not a matter where people will censor me. You did this. The body did this. Mind did this. I did not. Niravadyo, I am of the nature of unblemished reality. I am aware because I am unchanging. Because there is no lessening in me, because there is no gaining in me. I am not this deha, which is unreal. This the wise people call as knowledge. So different aspects of the reality have to be emphasized again and again. Niramayo nirabhaso nirvikalpo hamatatah naham deho hi asadrupo jnanam ityuchyate budhai. Amaya. Amaya means disease, whether bodily or mentally. I have no disease bodily or mentally. Neither I am body nor the mind, and in my real nature there is always constant, always without any disease, always blissful. Nirabhaso. Abhasa means appearance. Some appearance, that is world, that is body. I am not a matter of appearance, I am reality. Nirvikalpo. Nirvikalpo means there is nothing other than me, that is called I am nirvikalpo. Vikalpa means alternate, other than me. There is no such thing which is other than. See, the I has no dimension, I is all pervading. Because there is nothing which is not me. I am atata. Atata means I am extended. I am extended. That is not the small I. My real nature is extended. To the extent that there is nothing remains which is not me. I am not this body, which is of the unreal, made of unreal thing. This is called knowledge by the wise people. Nirguno nishkriyo nityo nitya mukto ham achyutaha naham deho hi asad rupo jnanam ityuchyate budhai. Nirguna means not without qualities, yes, without specific qualities, without sattva rajatama or any specific qualities, I am my real nature. Nishkriyo, I am doer, impossible. Consciousness cannot do something. Consciousness does not change to become the doer. Nityo, unchanging, eternally unchanging. Nitya mukta, I am always free. So long as I am in the realm of mind, I feel bondage and I can never become free. But in my real nature, I can never become bound. And this you have to experience in aparoksha anubhuti. So, nitya, nitya mukta, I am achyuta. I never change, I never fall down from chuti, means falling down. I never fall down from my real nature. That is my real nature. I am not this body, which is made of unreality. This is called knowledge by the wise people. One more. Nirmalo nishchalo anantaha shuddho aham ajaro amaraha naham deho hi asad rupo jnanam ityuchyate budhai. So the wise people call this as knowledge, that I am pure, unmixed, unadulterated, nishchalo. There is no movement in me, there is no change in me, ananta, I am infinite. I am infinite. Shuddho, I am always pure. Ajaro, there is no old age in me. Old age in the body and mind also. Amara, how can I die? When I am the reality, how can I die? This is my real nature. I am not this body, which is made of unreality. This is called knowledge by the wise people. So, like this, more thinking is necessary. One thinking has been established now, I am not the body. More such thinkings are necessary to make this I, our consciousness of I, free from all the mixtures of duality and reality. We have to do that further. So, we read up to 28 shlokas today. 29th we shall take up on Friday. I make a small announcement here. Centers have already received. Advaita Ashram, Calcutta, has asked me to deliver a series of 3 lectures on Sri Shankaracharya, his life and teachings, on the coming Sunday, Monday and Tuesday at the same time, 5:30 to 6:30. You will get the notice, but those who are hearing, I am already telling, and all the centers have already got that notice. So, this is a new something. This Sunday, Monday and Tuesday, 5:30, I will be talking of Shankaracharya, his life and teachings. Thank you. Om Shri Harim Paramanandam Upadeshta Aram Ishwaram Vyapakam Sarvalokanam Karanam Tam Namamyam. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.